If you got your Bibles there, please go ahead and open them up to John chapter 15, verse 9. John chapter 15, verse 9. And as you're turning there, just by way of reminder, we've just spent the last 3 weeks in a series called Start Here Psalms, some foundational psalms with some foundational truth for our lives. And we're going to continue today along the same Start Here theme with some foundational truth for our lives, but now from the New Testament. And if we could go anywhere in the New Testament to grab some foundational Start Here truth for our lives, it's right here in John chapter 15, verse 9. Because in John chapter 15, verse 9, we are confronted with the glory and the massiveness and the supernatural magnitude of the love that Jesus Christ has for us. Now, if I asked you, how much does Jesus Christ love you, what would you say? If you know Jesus Christ, you might say, well, he loves me a lot. And if I asked you, well, how do you know that? You'd probably say, well, because it says so in the Bible, and I even know the song. What's the song? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, right? But there's a difference between knowing something and then truly experiencing something in a profoundly life-changing way. There's a difference between knowing something here and then truly experiencing the depths of something here. If we were to see a picture of the Rocky Mountains, that's one thing, but it's another thing to stand on a glacier in Jasper. If we could have a look at a picture of an ocean, that's one thing that's beautiful, but it's another thing entirely to actually jump into an ocean. And so, question: how much would you say that you are actually experiencing and enjoying the depths of the love that Jesus Christ has for you? How much are you actually experiencing and enjoying the depths of the awesome love that Jesus Christ has for you? Because Moses, when he prayed like this. This is from Psalm 90. What an awesome prayer. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all of our days. Now let me ask you, was this you this week? This week, were you satisfied in the love of Jesus Christ? Was this a week for you where you were rejoicing in the love that Jesus Christ has for you? Was this a week where you were glad in the love of Jesus Christ? Because this is what happens when we're truly experiencing the love of Jesus Christ. Or consider what David said to the Lord in Psalm 63. He said, because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. Was that you this week? Were you praising the Lord with your lips? Were you praising Jesus Christ? Because to you this week, his perfect steadfast love was better to you than life. And I think for many of us, the answer would be, I wish that were the case. I know that he loves me here. I know it, but I'm not experiencing and enjoying his love here like I want to. And I can certainly relate to that. I can relate to that. Can anyone else relate to that? So what would happen then? What would happen if every true Christ follower here today somehow began to comprehend and experience and enjoy the love of Jesus Christ in a new and profoundly life-changing way? What would happen? Here's what would happen. We would begin to see the death of sin in our lives. We would begin to see the death of pride in our lives. Because pride cannot survive in the heart that is filled with the love of Jesus Christ. When our hearts are filled with his love, we love him most, not self. We would begin to see the death of idolatry in our lives because idols can't rule in the heart that is filled with the love of Jesus Christ. When our hearts are filled with love for Him, we worship Him, not idols. We would begin to see the death of fear in our lives because fear cannot flourish in the heart that is filled with the love of Jesus Christ. When our hearts are filled with His love, we place our trust in Him and we stop listening to the lies of the evil one. We begin to see the death of anger in our lives because sinful anger cannot live in the heart that is filled with the love of Jesus Christ. When our hearts are filled with His love, we see that we truly do have all we need, and we're not running around trying to get more stuff and then getting angry when we can't have it. And we'd see this, the death of despair in our lives, because despair cannot flourish in a heart that is filled with the love of Jesus Christ. Because when our hearts are truly filled with His love, here's what we're filled with: joy, supernatural joy. So why is it then that we all need to comprehend and experience and enjoy the love of Jesus Christ in a new and profoundly life-changing way? Here's why. Here's why. Because literally everything depends on it. Everything depends on it, because here's what's at stake: our hearts. Our hearts are at stake. Therefore, our lives are at stake, because whatever's ruling our hearts will rule our lives. And if our lives are not being ruled by the love of Jesus Christ, then our hearts will be ruled by something else. So if our hearts are at stake, then listen, literally everything is at stake. Everything is at stake. And so here's the question: how is it that we can comprehend and experience and enjoy the love of Jesus Christ in our lives to the full? How can that happen for me? How can that happen for you? How can that happen for us? Well, that leads us right into our first point, which is this. You can jot this down. I must receive this staggering truth. God loves me the way God loves God. I must receive this staggering truth. God loves me the way that God loves God. Have a look at chapter 15, John chapter 15, verse 9. Jesus says this: as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. Now, before rushing into these absolutely astonishing words of Jesus Christ, let's consider for a moment who it is that's actually speaking here. In Colossians chapter 1, Paul says this about Jesus Christ, that He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by Him all things were created in heaven and on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created by Him and through Him and for Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. This is the one who is speaking to us right now in John chapter 15, the creator of everything, the one who has all authority, the second person of the Trinity, the Son of God Himself, the Lord Jesus Christ. And what is He saying to us? What is He saying to us in John chapter 15? Well, verses 1 through 8 can be summarized in verse 5. Have a look at verse 5. Jesus says this: I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do, what does it say? Nothing. Nothing. So verses 1 through 8, Jesus is talking about He's the vine. We are the branches, and we can bear fruit. We can bear fruit that glorifies God as we draw from the vine everything that we need. We are totally 100% dependent on the vine, Jesus Christ. And then now in verse 9, He says one of the most staggering things that you will ever hear. And if you are able to receive it today, perhaps it will be one of the most heart-changing and life-altering things that you will ever hear. Look again at verse 9. Look what Jesus says. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now, as we try to consider what Jesus is actually saying here, let's read it all together. Okay, let's read it together. Here we go. Verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Here's what Jesus is saying. That if you are in him, if you are a branch in the vine, then he loves you. Listen, he loves you like the Father loves him. He loves you like the Father loves him. In other words, he's saying this, that God loves you the way that God loves God. God loves you the way that God loves God. Now, just try to let that sink in. God loves you the way that God loves God. And if you're anything like me, you know that for some reason it's just not sinking in the way that it should. For some reason it's just not sinking in the way that it needs to. If you're anything like me, it's like my mind is like a little cup. And this love of God is like this endless ocean. It just won't fit in. I just can't grasp it. I can't fit it into my mind. It seems way too good to be true and way too big to understand. And yet, here it is. Straight from the mouth of Jesus Christ. Verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Hear it. Hear it. God loves you the way that God loves God. He does. So how can that get in here, and then especially in here? Well, let's begin with this question. How much love exactly are we talking about? Because Jesus Christ doesn't just say, I love you. Look what he says. He says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. And so question, how much does the Father love Jesus Christ? How much does God the Father love God the Son? How much does God love God? How big is the love that God has for God? How high is that love? How deep is that love? How long is that love? How wide is that love? How big is the love that God has for God? Because if you can figure that out, that's how much Jesus Christ loves you. Again, listen to what he said. Verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Can you feel the weight of what he's saying here? Can you feel the weight? God loves you like God loves God. And therefore, a love that big, it must be expressed. A love that big, it cannot be contained. It must be displayed somehow. It has to be demonstrated. And if that's going to happen, if a love this big is somehow going to be demonstrated, it will be demonstrated with such intensity and such depth and such glory. It'll be nothing less than staggering, nothing less than breathtaking, nothing less than awe-inspiring for us to behold. And in the same way that the sun, it just can't contain its light, it must shine because it is a blazing inferno of hydrogen. Likewise, Jesus' love for you is a burning inferno that must shine. And listen, has shined. Has shined brighter than the sun in this, that he saved you. He saved you from the greatest suffering that there is, eternal suffering in hell. And he saved you to the greatest joy there is, eternal joy in God. and he saved you at the greatest cost there is, his cross. He saved you from the greatest suffering there is. He saved you to the greatest joy there is. He saved you at the greatest cost there is, his cross. Jesus Christ, he laid down his tortured, bloodied back on that cross, and he allowed men to drive spikes through his wrists and through his ankles. He was lifted up, and then as that darkness fell, he bore the full punishment for your sin and mine, the unfathomable wrath and fury of our God. So how much would Jesus Christ have to love you to take upon himself the wrath of God? Because if we can figure that out, then we'll understand how much Jesus Christ loves us. But here's the problem. My mind, my heart, it's just a glass. This love is too big. It's this endless ocean. I can't make it fit in. How can an ocean of love ever be poured into my heart so I can somehow understand it? Is there any way that I can force it to happen? If I just try really hard, can I force myself to understand this love? Listen, I can't do it, and neither can you. The only way that this will happen, the only way that this ocean of love, this endless ocean of love can be poured into your heart and into mine is supernaturally, period. That's the only way. The Holy Spirit himself must do it. It must be done supernaturally by the Holy Spirit. And this is exactly what the Holy Spirit does when we ask him. He supernaturally pours out the love of Jesus Christ into our hearts so that we experience more of his love than we ever thought possible. This is how we supernaturally comprehend and experience and enjoy the love of Jesus Christ in a profoundly life-changing way. And this is exactly what the Apostle Paul prayed for in Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3 up on the screen. Paul was praying in Ephesians chapter 3 that God would give the Ephesians believing hearts, hearts that are filled with faith. And then he kind of turns a corner and he prays this way. He says that you Ephesians, being rooted and grounded in love. They are in Jesus Christ, therefore they are rooted in his love. They're like a tree, and they've got their roots down into the love of Jesus Christ, rooted in love and grounded in love. The foundation of their lives is the love of Jesus Christ, that you being rooted and grounded in love may have strength. Strength from who? Strength from the Holy Spirit. Strength from the Holy Spirit to comprehend, to understand something, to comprehend with all the saints. That's us, all the saints. What is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. This is what Paul is praying for, that the Holy Spirit would work in their hearts in such a way, opening up their hearts in such a way, teaching them in such a way that they would understand supernaturally the dimensions of the love of Jesus Christ, how big it is, how awesome it is, how vast it is, how glorious it is. And it's something that surpasses knowledge. It's not something that we can understand. We must be taught supernaturally by the Holy Spirit, which leads then to this: that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. That we would be under the influence completely of the Holy Spirit. That our hearts would be filled with love for Jesus Christ. We can think of it like this, up on the screen. God's love for you is like a river, a mighty river that's heading to us, and we receive the love of Jesus Christ, but our capacity to understand it, our capacity to grab hold of it, it's so limited. The only way that the love of Jesus Christ is going to be poured down into our hearts like a waterfall is for the Holy Spirit himself to teach us, to show us supernaturally how great his love is. We need supernatural understanding, and this is exactly what the Holy Spirit does. The love of God flows to us. And then like a waterfall, the Holy Spirit pours it into our heart. And when he does that, he also produces in us a reservoir of love for God. This is what he does. This is how he transforms our hearts and lives. The love of God flows to us. The Holy Spirit, as we call upon him and ask him, he pours out a supernatural understanding of this awesome, great love. And then he also produces in us a deep reservoir of love for God. This is what the Spirit of God does when we ask. So what do we need to do then to understand what Jesus Christ is saying to us in John chapter 15, verse 9, when he says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Well, here's what we must do. We must pray. We must pray that God would empower us supernaturally to comprehend this love of Jesus Christ, so that when we open up the Bible and we read about the good news of Jesus Christ, when we open up the Bible and we read about the love of Jesus Christ, when we open up the Bible and we read about the cross, when we open up to John chapter 15, verse 9, and read these words, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you, that we would be empowered even today, right now, by the Spirit of God, to somehow supernaturally comprehend and experience and enjoy this massive and glorious love of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Because when we start to really understand this reality, that God loves us like God loves God, it changes everything. When we really begin to understand how much Jesus Christ loves us, it changes everything. That's when we see the death of pride. That's when we see the death of idolatry. That's when we see the death of fear. That's when we see the death of anger. That's where we see the death of despair in our hearts and lives, because these things cannot survive in the heart that is filled with the love of Jesus Christ. I must receive this staggering truth. God loves me like God loves God. And notice what Jesus says next in verse 9. Look at the end of verse 9. He says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Look what he says next. Abide in my love. Abide in my love. So what does that mean? Well, when Jesus commands us here to abide in his love, here's what he's commanding. That we would not just know his love, we wouldn't just comprehend his love, but we would press in even further and live in his love. That we would press in even further and enjoy his love to the full. And so how do we do that? Well, that leads us to our next point. You could jot this down. Our next point is this. I must believe this wonderful promise. If I obey, I will abide in God's love. I must believe this wonderful promise. If I obey, I will abide in God's love. Jesus continues in verse 10. Look what he says. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. Just as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. And so what does it mean to abide here again in the love of Jesus Christ? It means this, that it's not just supernaturally comprehending this love on some level, but it's also then pressing in further and living our lives in that love and living in that love and enjoying it to the full. Jesus wants us to make our home in this love and enjoy his love to the full. Which ultimately means this, that Jesus Christ wants us to live in such a way that our understanding and our experience and our enjoyment of his love doesn't decrease over the years and over the decades, but rather increases over the years and over the decades. He wants us to live in such a way that our experience and our understanding and our enjoyment of his love that doesn't decrease over the years, but only increases over the years. And so how do we live like that? Well, look what he says at the end of verse 9, he says, abide in my love. In verse 10, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. So Jesus here is giving himself as an example, our example of how to live in the love of God. He tells us that he had a particular lifestyle, a lifestyle that ensured that he lived in the love of his Father and enjoyed it to the full. And so what was that lifestyle? It was this, a lifestyle of obedience. A lifestyle of obedience. Look again at verse 10. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Jesus, he enjoyed his Father's love to the full by keeping his Father's commandments. And so what commandments are we talking about here exactly? Well, we're talking about all of them. All of them. At all times, Jesus Christ loved God with all his heart, mind, soul, and strength. At all times, perfectly, always. At all times, he loved his neighbor as himself, perfectly, without fail. And because of this lifestyle of obedience, Jesus enjoyed his Father's love, listen, to the full. Which begs this question. What's the connection here between Jesus' obedience and his enjoyment of the Father's love? What's the connection between Jesus' obedience and his enjoyment of the Father's love? Because it kind of seems like one leads to the other, sort of like a glass of water on a really, really hot day leads to refreshment. Or a hot fire on a freezing cold night leads to comfort. Or a perfectly cooked filet mignon in my mouth leads to such deliciousness. Sorry, vegans. What's the connection? What's the connection? One leads to the other. What's the connection between Jesus' obedience and his enjoyment of the Father's love? Well, we can think of it like this. When Jesus Christ walked on this earth, the most important thing to him was communion and intimacy with the Father. That was the most important thing. The most important thing to Jesus Christ was communion and intimacy with the Father. And that communion, that intimacy with the Father, took place as he walked with the Father on the path of obedience. That intimacy, that communion between God the Father and God the Son took place as Jesus Christ walked with his Father on the path of obedience. And now Jesus says to us in verse 10 that what was true of him is also true for us. Look again at verse 10. He says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. In other words, Jesus is promising us here that just as he had communion and intimacy with the Father on the path of obedience, that we will have communion and intimacy with him on the path of obedience. We can think of it maybe like this. The more that we walk on the path of obedience with Jesus Christ, the more we will have communion and intimacy with Jesus Christ. And the more we have intimacy and communion with Jesus Christ, the more we will know and enjoy his love. And if we're going to walk on the path of obedience with Jesus Christ, seriously, it's going to require this, that we walk away from every other path. It's going to require that we walk away from the path of sin. We can think of it like this. Jesus Christ is commanding us to walk in obedience with him. This is the way he wants us to go. He wants us to go this way. And as we walk on the path of obedience with him, we will have intimacy and fellowship and communion with him, and we will know and enjoy his love. He's saying, let's go this way together. Let's go, let's go. Therefore, it is impossible for us to both be walking on the path of obedience and on the path of sin. We can't walk in two different directions at the same time. Two can't walk together if they're going in different directions. Jesus Christ is saying to us, let's go this way. And so we just need to choose the path of obedience, right? Seems so simple. And in many ways it is that simple. But that doesn't mean it's easy. Because there's this thing that's still living inside of us called the flesh that's always, always, always pulling us toward the path of sin. So how do we find the strength to choose to walk on the path of obedience with Jesus Christ? Well, consider what Jesus said about this very thing in chapter 14. Turn over the page to John chapter 14. Have a look at verse 15, where Jesus addresses this very question. John chapter 14, verse 15. Jesus says this. He says, if, you see that? If you love me, you will keep my commandments. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. If you love me, you'll walk with me on the path of obedience. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Or look at verse 21. Verse 21. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. Or look at verse 23. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. I think we're seeing a pattern here. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. Look at verse 24. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. So for sure, we're seeing a pattern here. Do you see it? The more we love Jesus Christ, the more we will walk with Jesus Christ on the path of obedience. Do you see that? The more we love Jesus Christ, the more we will walk with Jesus Christ on the path of obedience. And the more we walk with Jesus Christ on the path of obedience, the more we will have communion and intimacy and fellowship with him and enjoy his love. And maybe you're thinking to yourself, you keep saying this path of obedience thing. It's kind of getting irritating. This path of obedience, what is that? It's just so vague. What does that actually mean to walk on this path of obedience? What does it look like? Well, calm down. Okay. Here's what it looks like. Jesus tells us exactly what it looks like in verse 12 of chapter 15. Chapter 15, verse 12. Jesus tells us what this path of obedience looks like. Look what he says. He says, this is my commandment. Verse 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. There it is. Pretty straightforward, right? Just love others the way that Jesus has loved you. Love others the way that Jesus has loved me? Like, seriously? Love others the way that Jesus has loved me? That seems kind of completely impossible. To love others the way I'm supposed to walk that path of obedience? Loving others the way Jesus Christ has loved me? But consider how Jesus Christ has loved you. Jesus Christ loved you by giving you his very best, which means this. He gave you himself. And now he's commanding us to give others our very best, which is also himself. The way we love others best is by pointing them to Jesus Christ. That's the way we love others best, by pointing them to Jesus Christ with our words and with our actions. This is the path of obedience that Jesus Christ wants us to walk with him. And the more that this is our lifestyle, the more our lifestyle is walking with Jesus Christ and pointing others to Jesus Christ, the more we will have intimacy and communion and fellowship with him, and the more we will know and enjoy his love. I love the way that John Piper puts it. Look on the screen. Look what he says. He says, if you live gladly to make others glad in God, your life will be hard, your risks will be high, and your joy will be full. If you live gladly to make others glad in God, your life will be hard, your risks will be high, and your joy will be full. And I can remember a couple of months ago, sitting here in a service. It was before the service, and you know, before the service, we have those kind of pre-service slides that roll. There was a slide that came up that talked about a missions trip to a place called Fort Hope, and as soon as I saw that slide, I knew I gotta go. And I'd seen slides for Fort Hope, and I saw this one. I was like, I just really believe the Lord wants me to go. And so I applied and got on the team, and a small team of us went to this place called Fort Hope, which is a First Nations community about 350 kilometers north of Thunder Bay. Okay, so that's like really far. There's no roads that go there. You got to get on like a 9-seater plane and fly there. And just kind of moment of transparency, I was a little bit intimidated, and I didn't know what to expect, and what is this going to be like, and I have no idea, and literally, it was as the wheels hit the ground on their little airport grass runway, we just saw the Lord start to move, and start to do things, and we were there just like a couple of hours, and a believer in the community came to us, and just started talking to us, and he just started telling us everything about his life, and being a counselor at this church, I'm telling you, I have never seen this kind of transparency before. And I really wasn't even asking many questions. He just came. He just started telling us about his life. And the Lord just so obviously led us from conversation to conversation to conversation, where people in the community, these believers there, were telling us about the horrors. Just things that we've never... The horrors of residential schools. Sexual abuse. Homicides and suicides and darkness. And as hard as it was to listen to all of this pain, the Lord was in it. And as we pointed these believers to Jesus Christ, we just experienced the presence of the Lord in such a profoundly powerful way, and we just experienced his love there, and I would not change it for the world, and I can't wait to get back. God has really placed those folks in my heart. And I was thinking to myself when we got back that ought not to be something that only happens on missions trips, you know? That ought to be the way that we live our lives. That intimacy and that communion and fellowship with God as we're pointing others to Jesus Christ, that should be the way we live. We should be living on mission. So ask yourself, am I pointing others to Jesus Christ in my life? I mean, am I really pointing others to Jesus Christ with my words and with my actions? Is that really my lifestyle, is it? Was that my lifestyle this week? If you're married, ask yourself, this week, did I point my spouse to Jesus Christ with my words and with my actions? Because this is what love looks like. This is what your spouse needs most from you, for you to point them to Jesus Christ. If you were a parent in the room, ask yourself this week, did I point my children to Jesus Christ with my words and with my actions? Because this is what love looks like. This is what your kids need from you most. If Harvest is your home church, ask yourself this week, did I point some of the saints I know in this church to Jesus Christ? Because this is what love looks like, pointing others to Jesus Christ with our words and with our actions. How about your coworkers or your peers at school? Ask yourself this week, did I point any of them to Jesus Christ with my words or with my actions? Because this is what they need most from you. And as you consider these questions, if you can see If you can see a lack of love for people in your heart and life, like I so often see a lack of love for people in my heart and in my life, if you can see that right now, listen, don't be discouraged. That's not a bad thing right now to see that, because if we can't see the problem, then we can't ever face the problem. It's not until we can see that we have this lack of love for others that we get so desperate that we begin to call out to God in prayer and say, God, would you please fill me with your love? Would you open up my eyes? Show me how much you love me. And would you fill me with love for you? And would you fill me with love for others? And as the Holy Spirit begins to respond to those prayers, that's when we begin to supernaturally comprehend and experience and enjoy the love of Jesus Christ in a new and profoundly life-changing way. That's when our hearts begin to fill supernaturally with love for Jesus Christ. And that's when we begin to walk with Jesus Christ on the path of obedience. Whether that looks like sponsoring a child, or whether that looks like going on a missions trip, or whether that looks like serving in this church, or being a light in your neighborhood, or being a light in your home, a light in your everyday life, whatever that looks like for you, as the Spirit of God is working on your heart and filling it with how much Jesus Christ loves you, you will want to walk on the path of obedience with Him. And the more we do that, the more we walk on the path of obedience with Jesus Christ, the more we will have intimacy and fellowship with Him, and the more we will abide in His love. So ask yourself, do I really want to abide in the love of Jesus Christ? Do I really want to enjoy the love of Jesus Christ to the full? If so, I must do this. I must walk the path of obedience with Him, because that's how we abide in the love of Jesus Christ. So to recap, I must receive this staggering truth. God loves me the way God loves God. Awesome. I must believe this wonderful promise. If I obey, I'll abide in God's love. Incredible. And now thirdly, I must do this, jot this down. I must pursue this glorious outcome. If I abide, I'll be filled with God's joy. I must pursue this glorious outcome. If I abide, I'll be filled with God's joy. Now have a look at verse 11. Verse 11, Jesus continues. Look what he says. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. And so everything Jesus has said to us in the text today is leading to this. This is the main point. This is the purpose. This is the glorious outcome of abiding in his love. It's this, that Jesus' joy would be in us. Jesus' joy would be in us. Verse 11, these things I've spoken to you that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. So here's what we need to see, that when you abide in the love of Jesus Christ, you will be filled with the joy of Jesus Christ. When you abide in the love of Jesus Christ, you will be filled with the joy of Jesus Christ. And listen, it does not get any better than this. This is as good as it gets. This is a taste of heaven. This is what we will be experiencing for all of eternity. Because notice in verse 11 that Jesus doesn't say that he just wants us to have joy. And he doesn't just say that he wants us to be filled with joy. What does he say? He says this, that he has spoken these things so that his joy would be in us. And so what is Jesus' joy? Well, Jesus' joy ultimately is this. It's joy in God. It's this fullness of joy that Jesus has had for all of eternity in God. It's the joy that exists within the Trinity. It's God's joy in God. That's Jesus' joy. So consider what he's actually saying here in verse 11. These things I've spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. So here's what he's saying. That as we supernaturally begin to comprehend the greatness of his love, and as we walk the path of obedience with him and abide in his love, here's the outcome. Here's what happens. The supernatural joy that God has in God will flood our hearts, and our joy then will be super abundantly full. Because Jesus' joy is a supernatural joy in God that is not dependent on our circumstances. Consider this. Jesus' joy is the same supernatural joy that sustained him as he suffered on the cross. Hebrews 12:2 says this, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Now, if Jesus' joy was enough to sustain him as he endured the cross, then Jesus' joy is also more than enough to sustain us through anything. Amen? And so how can we lay hold of this supernatural joy in God? Well, here's how. It begins with prayer. It begins with calling out to God and asking him to fill our hearts with the knowledge of his love for us, asking him to fill our hearts with love for him, and then asking him to fill our hearts with love for others. And listen, this isn't a prayer we just pray one time and then that's it. This is a prayer we need to continue praying again and again. God, fill us with more of your love, God, because we are just ever going to scratch the surface. This is a bottomless ocean of love that we will be in for all of eternity. And as the Holy Spirit begins to respond to this prayer and move and work, that's when we begin to supernaturally comprehend and experience and enjoy this awesome love of Jesus Christ in a new and profoundly life-changing way. This is when our hearts begin to fill with love for him. This is when we begin to walk with Jesus on the path of obedience. And this is when we begin to abide in his love. And this, loved ones, is the path of joy. The path of joy is the path of abiding in the love of Jesus Christ. The path of joy is abiding in this glorious, awesome love that we get to celebrate right now